Spirit, Father and our God. Truly, Lord, it's an awesome privilege coming before your presence, not because we're worthy, but here. We ask, Lord, tonight that you will be with us. We ask in a very special way, Lord, that as we come on this platform tonight, Lord, that we will give you all the praise and the glory that we to you. As we go into our song service even now, we ask, Lord, that you tune our hearts, our minds, Lord, that as we will sing until your glory comes down and fill our hearts. Lord, be with each and every worshiper tonight. Those who are visiting with us, we ask you to be with everything. And may, Lord, we be revived and be refreshed and renewed to continue on this journey until you come. Bless us and help us to have a wonderful evening in worshiping you. And may we worship you in spirit and in truth. Please forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Lord, help us to give you and you alone praise and glory and honor. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Our first hymn is hymn number 183, I Will Sing of Jesus' Love.
I will sing of Jesus' love, sing of him, who first loved me before he left, bright words above, and died on Calvary. I will sing of Jesus' love, endless praise, my heart shall give. He is done that I might live. I will sing his love to me. Oh, the depth of love divine, earth or realm can never know how they sing. As dark as mine can be made as white as snow. I will sing of Jesus' love, endless praise, my heart shall give. He is done that I might. I will sing his love to me. Nothing good for him I've done, how could he such love bestowed, Lord, I own. My heart is one, help me now my love to show. I will sing of Jesus' love, endless praise, my heart shall give. He is thine that I might live. I will sing his love to me.
Our next hymn is hymn number 434. Hymn number 434. We speak of the realms of the blessed.
We speak of the realms of the blessed, the country so bright and so fair, and of all its glories confess, but what must it be to be there? We speak of its sparkling of gold, its wonders with joy is so rare, its wonders and pleasures untold. But what must it be to be there? We speak of its freedom of sin, from sorrow, temptation, and care, from trials without and within. But what must it be to be there? We speak of its service of love, of the world which the glorified wear, of the church of the firstborn above, but what must it be to be there? Our morning is all at an end when raised by the life-giving word. We see the new city descend, adored as a bride for our Lord. The city so holy and clean, no sorrow can breathe in the air, no gloom of affliction or sin, no sorrow of evil is there. Do not mix temptation and woe, for heaven my spirit prepare, and surely I also shall know and feel what it is to be there. Then all the bright fields we shall roam in glory celestial and fair, with saints and with angels at home, and Jesus himself will be there.
Our next hymn is hymn number 511. Hymn number 511. I know whom I believe. I know not what God's wondrous grace to me he hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed me on his own. But I know, I believe that, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against the day. I know not how this saving faith to me he did impart, nor how believing in his word brought peace within my heart. But I know, I believe it, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against the day. I know not how the Spirit moves, convincing men of sin, revealing Jesus through the word, creating faith in him. But I know, I believe it, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know not when my Lord may come at night or noonday fair, nor if I walk the veil with him or meet him in the air. But I know, I believe it, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against the day. Our next hymn is hymn number 529. Under his wings I am safely abiding.
Under his wings I'm safely abiding, though the night deepens and tempests are wild, still I can trust him. I know he will keep me. He has redeemed me and I am his child. Under his wings, who from his love can sever. Under his wings my soul shall abide, safely abide forever. Under his wings, what a refuge in sorrow, how the heart yearningly turns to its rest. Often when earth has no bound for my healing, there I find comfort and there I am blessed. Under his wings, who from his love can sever. Under his wings, my soul shall abide, safely abide forever. Under his wings, oh, what precious enjoyment, there will I hide till life's trials are o'er. Shelter protected, no evil can harm me. Resting in Jesus, I'm safe evermore. Under his wings, who from his love can sever. Under his wings, my soul shall abide, safely abide forever.
Our next hymn is hymn number 426. I shall see the King where the angels sing. Hymn number 426.
I shall see the King where the angels sing. I shall see the King someday in the better way. On the golden thread, and with him shall ever stay. In his glory, I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary, Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday. In the land of song, in the glory throng, where there never comes a night, with my Lord once slain, I shall ever reign in the glory land of light. In his glory, I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas in Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday.
I shall
see the King, all my tributes bring, and shall look upon his face. Then my song shall be how he ransomed me and has kept me by his grace. In his glory, I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas in Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday.
Thank you all for joining us for our song service. Until tomorrow.
Good evening, everyone. Special welcome to you all. Thank you, Enriz, for that lovely and wonderful song service. I know that next time Malachi will join in. Okay, welcome, welcome one and all. We are grateful that you could be out tonight. Last night was, trust me, it was a special night in Seaview when we lost the current and the internet. But nevertheless, brethren, while I was here in darkness, I prayed, and the Lord does answer our prayers. The message has to go forth, and there is nothing or no one that can stop God's word from coming to pass. And as we gather here night after night, the question is asked, will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? And the response from him that he will revive the lowly in heart and the contrite one. He will. His words stand forever and they are true. I just want to say welcome. We have here on our platform, I'm seeing 32 devices. And I just want to say welcome to you one and all. I know that we have overseas persons online. We have the Olympic Way Seventh-day Adventist Church, the Penwood Seventh-day Adventist Church, and Seaview Garden Seventh-day Adventist Church, the Penwood Churches of District. And we're grateful that you could all be here with us tonight. You know, brethren, this is for us. We need a renewal. We need a reviving. If we were waning in our walk with Christ, this is what we need. We need the word of God to know bear fruit in our life. And who else can do it? For those who have been with us from the first night, there is nothing in us, but there is something that is greater than us, outside of us, that can revive and renew us. And that is why we are here. We are yearning and we are longing and we want a change. Many of us can feel it. I'm going to begin with our team text. And this is taken from Isaiah 40 verses 30 to 31. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Amen, brethren. We know that these words will stand forever. At this time, we're going to turn over to our technical team, and they will be giving us our theme song, Revive Us, Lord. Then that will be followed by prayer from Sister Denise Skiff.
Revive us, Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Revive us, Lord, make us like your Son. Revive us, Lord, speak your word so we can hear it. Revive us, Lord.
Break them, mold them to a new creation.
creation. Revive us, Lord. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Revive us, Lord. Make us like your Son. Revive us, Lord. Speak your word so we can hear it. Revive us, Lord, till we all are one. Make us like your Son, till we all are one.
Amen. Let us pray. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Divine Father, we truly thank you for spirit life and tender mercy. We thank you for your keeping care from morning until now. Tonight is another night where you had message to share with us and to impart with us. And we want to ask, loving Lord, that you will be with the visitors who are online. May you bless them in a mighty way. Be with us as members, Lord. May you revive us and give us a heart like thine. Tonight I place a speaker before you as he stand in your space tonight, Lord, to share your word another night. Lord, may he not be seen, but Father God, may you be seen high and lifted up as your message go forth. May it pierce our heart and make us better citizens for your kingdom. Continue to have your way. Be with those who are sick and more. Among us, Lord, we pray for healing for them. Be with those who are going through a trying time, Lord. I pray that you will strengthen, grant us strength, grant us healing, grant us the victory. Help us to continue to press on and continue to look to you, God's loving Father. You are indeed the author and the finisher of our faith. We thank you for everything that you have done and that you are going to do in our lives tonight. As we say thanks now for hearing and for answering. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We are here tonight to hear. And when we hear, the message is to be implanted in us. We will now take a special from Sister Alina Benjamin, special in song from Sister Alina Benjamin. And this will be followed by our special feature on stewardship.
There's a list a mile long of all my sins, of everything that I've done wrong. I'm so ashamed. There's nowhere left for me to hide. This is the day I'm a center for my life. My fate was in the judge's hands, but then he turned to me and says, I know you, I love you, I gave my life to save you. My verdict, my king. pay the price of all my sins. I stand in awe. Now that I have been set free, and the tears well up as I look in the cup, for they should have been me. My fate was in the nail-scarred hands. He stretched them out to me and says, I know you, I love you, I gave my life to save you. The price for mercy, my verdict, not guilty. I'm falling on my knees to thank you. With everything I am, I praise you. So grateful for the words I hear you say. I know you, I love you, I gave my life. I know you, I love you, I gave my life to save you. Love paid the price for mercy. My verdict, not guilty. Love paid the price for mercy. My verdict, not guilty.
Amen, amen, my verdict, not guilty. Such love that we cannot, tongue cannot describe how marvelous and wonderful this God is to us. At this time, we are actually going to have our quiz before our special feature. So I am now going to hand over to Sister Andrea McNeil, who will be taking us through our quiz for tonight. And then we will have our special feature.
Good evening, everyone. We are going to review last night's quiz before we begin. And I want to remind you that at the end of this review, the tech team will place the link for tonight's quiz in the chat. And that is where you are going to access the questions for tonight's quiz. So let's review the questions from last night's quiz. The first question was, the metaphor of rain is used in Hosea 6 to describe the Holy Spirit. That was true. Question number two. Four essentials for revival are the word, the spirit, the heart, and prayer. That was also true. Question number three. To have a successful ministry, you need to speak in tongues. Of course, we know that's false. Question number four, to experience a revival of primitive godliness, we have to live according to the scripture or to the word of God. And that was indeed true. And the final question from last night's quiz was, in Joel 2, we learned that in the last days, God will pour out his spirit on some people. And that was false. We had one winner from last night's quiz. One lucky person was able to claim that virtual prize. And I know she was very happy. So let's get started with this evening's quiz. I'm going to read the questions quickly for those of us who also need to hear as well as see. As you access the link in the chat, let's go through tonight's questions really quickly. Question number one. Last night's topic was good versus evil. Question number two. Romans 5 verses 8 to 10 teaches us that we should wait, or we rather shouldn't wait, on an apology before we forgive. True or false? Question number three. One person in the Bible that Pastor Shea referenced as having the mind of Jesus when it comes to forgiveness and godliness is, and that's going to be a multiple choice answer. You can choose the one that you remember. Question number four. In the video clip that we saw about forgiveness, the best thing that the brother of the victim said that could happen to the accused was for her to spend the rest of her life thinking about all that she had done. And our final question for this evening is, in order for us to lead people to Christ, we must display God's goodness. These are the questions for tonight's quiz. I wish you all the best as you choose the correct answer so that you can be lucky enough to claim that virtual prize. I'll see you tomorrow evening with the quiz. Have a good evening.
Stewardship. A steward is defined as a manager, a treasurer, or one who takes care of the master's business until he returns. When we make the commitment to follow Christ, we become stewards in his kingdom, managers of the resources that God grants to us. Psalms 24:1 says, "The earth is the Lord's, and the faithfulness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein." When we understand that everything belongs to God and that we are appointed to manage His resources, ownership ends and stewardship begins. So what are we actually stewards of? God grants everyone different amounts of resources to use, but we all have the ability to use what we have to enhance the kingdom. There are things like our time, talents, our bodies, the gospel, opportunities, our finances, and much more. Imagine that you store your resources in a bucket. At any time, you can add to and take away for various things. When you get paid or have a day off, you put those resources in your bucket. Perhaps you have to pay some bills or you want to buy someone lunch. Some will have to be taken out. Either way, there is a supply and demand. When we accept Jesus Christ into our lives, though, a new source comes into play. We no longer own the bucket. We no longer own the resources. We do, however, have access to them and decide how to use them. We are now stewards. Imagine all the amazing things we can do now. Think of all the people we could bless and all the ministries that could flourish. God's love can infiltrate every facet of our lives. Unfortunately, things don't always play out that way. We have a natural tendency to revert back to an ownership viewpoint over these resources that we're blessed with. The common misconception is, I earn this. I deserve this. This is mine. This mindset puts a lid on our bucket. We shut God out. This is the basis of poor stewardship. Now that's not to say that you can't still do great things with what you have, but you have removed God from the system and now have some resources being wasted. We aren't able to fully utilize all of God's blessings. We cannot serve two masters. On the contrary, however, when we remove the lid and submit fully to serving the Lord in every aspect of our lives, the dynamic of stewardship changes drastically. Our God is not a thief. These offerings, tithes, and sacrifices that we give to Him are going to be blessed and used in amazing ways to transform lives for the kingdom. He uses ordinary people to become extraordinary in a broken world that needs a foundation of love. By offering ourselves completely to His will, we allow the Holy Spirit to work transparently through us in a powerful way. Lives will be changed. Miracles will happen. and ultimately broken people can learn that they are sons and daughters of a loving God. We will become great stewards. Our buckets will always be changing. In some cases, they will be empty. In others, they will overflow. In all cases, God will use us to do incredible things. Stewardship is a choice. Let's choose God.
Amen. Amen. Every aspect of our lives, everything that we do when we come to Christ, belong to Him, and we receive it from Him. There is nothing that we receive or can do of ourselves without Him. And that is a lovely reminder of what God is to us and how important He is. At this time, I'm going to invite Sister Marcia Guthrie, and she will be doing the introduction of speaker, and then this will be followed by our meditation song.
Good evening, everyone. Tonight, I'd just like to say welcome to everyone. This speaker tonight, well, let me tell you a little about him.
Good evening.
Tapino.
A plane ride gone awry evokes images of horror and fear. How many people survive such a catastrophe and live to tell about it? This is a riveting story you won't ever forget. Alden Ho does not consider himself lucky, but rather a life that has been spared by divine intervention. He was born in Singapore and raised in Toronto, Canada. He is an ordained minister, energetic speaker, musician, photographer, and a cyclist who loves to use his God-given talents to bring people to a saving knowledge and a saving relationship with Jesus. He has a master's degree in youth ministry, and he has devoted his time to serving and reaching out to youth and young adults around the world, along with preaching at revival and evangelistic campaigns. He currently works with the Amazing Facts Ministries, and he and his lovely wife, Lynn, has three children, Austin, and his twin girls, Lauren and Madison. I ask that you pray for him tonight as he comes to us with a message from God, and I pray that you, as you listen, you will be blessed. We welcome you, Pastor Alden Ho, as you come to us. We will now have the meditation song.
Good evening, everybody. And I just need somebody to give me a visual to know whether you can hear me or not. Can somebody give me a message?
I can hear you.
You can hear me. Praise the Lord.
Yes, Pastor Ho.
Hello, Jamaica. How are you? I miss my Jamaican friends. Not too many out here in California. But when I grew up in Toronto, that is really not Toronto. That is Jamaica number two, because that's where everybody who left Jamaica went to reside. So I'm very happy to be able to worship with you and share with you tonight a revival message that's titled Listening for God. Listening for God. So before we begin, let's bow our heads, shall we, as we ask the Lord to be with us. Our loving Father, we thank you once again that we have the privilege to be able to come and to be revived this evening. I ask that you would take me and that you would allow me just to be a nail on the wall so that these young people may see the picture of Christ hung from this nail. Father, do not allow me to get in the way of the message, but I pray that in spite of myself, you would speak to your people and that they will hear not my words, but they may hear the Holy Spirit speaking to them as we talk about listening to God. Be with us this evening, we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In New York City, if you've ever been there, it is one crazy place. And there was a Native American Indian that stood right there waiting to cross a very, very busy section of New York, right located in Times Square. And as he was waiting there, his friend was next to him, and he was a native New Yorker. And as the Native American and the New Yorker were there talking, they were conversing back and forth amidst the buses, the crazy taxi cabs, the street preachers, and all the noise that's going on. And all of a sudden, in the middle of that conversation, the Native American Indian stops silent and he says, "I hear a cricket." The New Yorker looks at him and says, you hear what? He says, "I hear a cricket." And the New Yorker says, "But how?" And as soon as he said that, the light turned green. And immediately the Native American Indian walked across the street, and right there across the other side of the street was a big planter with a big bush that was growing up. And the Native American Indian put his hand in the bush and he opened it. And sure enough, right there in the middle of that bush was a cricket. The New Yorker was beside himself and he was saying, "How in the world could you hear this cricket amidst all this noise?" The Indian said to him, "It all depends on what you're used to listening for." The New Yorker scratched his head, thinking, "What are you talking about?" The Indian said once again, "It all depends on what you're used to listening for." He says, "Watch, I'll show you." And right there, amidst all the traffic, the pedestrians, people walking and shopping and running to work, he takes out a handful of coins in his hand, and he takes them and he throws them onto the sidewalk. And as soon as those coins started hitting the sidewalk, all eyes within 50 feet focused on the coins. Money. The New Yorker nodded his head. "Okay, I get it." You see, young people, this is the problem that we are facing today. Satan has turned up the volume of the world so loud that you can't hear very much outside of advertisements, TVs, movie ads, magazines, your friends telling you need to do this, your friends telling you need to wear this, your friends telling you need to be this, all the different things. But the problem is this. Many of us are not listening, and we're not in tune with what God sounds like. Let's take our Bibles here and see what our first verse is speaking to us about. In the book of Kings, 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse 11. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 11. We're going to identify in here, what does God really sound like? 1 Kings 19, verse 11. And he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. No, just let me get you caught up for where this story goes. Elijah was scared of Jezebel, and he immediately took off running. This is way after the whole showdown that happened on Mount Carmel with the 850 priests of Baal and Asherah, and God answered by fire, licked up the water, burnt the offerings, roasted the rocks, everything was gone. Now, Elijah is very, very nervous. He takes off. He's scared because of Jezebel's threat, and he goes running off. He eventually ends up in this cave, and he's hiding out there in the cave. And here's what happens. So the Lord calls him to come out. And it says here, go forth and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind rent the mountains and break into pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. And so it was, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle, and he went out and stood in the entering part of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what doest thou here, Elijah? What are you doing here, man? Elijah didn't know what else to say. All the excuses. You see, this particular text goes to tell us that God is not speaking to us in this voluminous, huge, booming voice. He doesn't speak to us in the wind. He doesn't speak to us in the earthquake. He doesn't speak to us in the fire. God is a still small voice. Here's the challenge that we have today. How do you hear the still small voice when you've got your Bluetooth earbuds in, you got your AirPods, and you might be jamming to the music? How are you hearing God when God is trying to speak to you, but you're not in tune to listening for him? This is extremely important because we are in the last days. And if you haven't noticed, all you have to do is just start looking around and you'll see, look, we're told that there would be rumors of wars and wars. That's happening in Ukraine with Russia. There will be famines. There will be pestilence. There will be earthquakes in various places. And we're told all these are just the beginnings of birth pains. We're still not there yet, because what's coming next is persecution. When the persecution starts hitting, then you're going to start wishing, man, I wish God would tell me where to go. I wish God would tell me what I should say. You know what? It could be that God is already telling you these things. You're just not identifying his voice because you're not used to listening for his voice. That's the problem that we had in this next verse in 1 Samuel chapter 3. There was a little boy named Samuel. Samuel was the cherished son of Hannah, who didn't have children. And she prayed. God gave her a little boy named Samuel. When he was 5 years old, Hannah brought him to the temple. The story picks up here in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 1. And now the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord before Eli. And the word of the Lord was rare in those days, meaning that it didn't say much. God didn't speak very much. He had his prophets. He spoke through his prophets, but they weren't used to listening for the voice of God. Verse 2 says, and it came to pass at that time, while Eli was lying down in his place, and when his eyes had begun to grow dim that he could not see, perhaps he had cataracts, he could have had some vision problems, so he was having some old age issues. And it says in verse 3, and before the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was, and while Samuel was lying down, that the Lord called Samuel. You can imagine the echoing amidst the stone, maybe the tile that was in Samuel's room. Samuel being only 5, 6 years old, maybe was a little older at that time. All of a sudden, the voice says, Samuel. Samuel jumps up. He says, Priest Eli's calling me. So he runs over and he says, here I am, for you call me. Eli is probably almost half asleep. And he's like, what? I did not call you, Samuel. Go lie down. Samuel, being the obedient boy that he is, he goes and he lies down. He's almost asleep. And then the Lord calls Samuel again. Samuel. Samuel arises again. He runs over to priest Eli's room and he says, here I am, for you called me. Eli's like, no, son, I didn't call you. Go lie down. Now, it says here, now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord revealed to him. That's a big clue, a big clue. Because you see, hearing comes by reading. Reading comes by the word of the Lord. If you are not reading your Bible, then you're not in tune with what God sounds like or how God talks. Because you're too busy on Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat. God is not speaking to you through those. God speaks to you through his word. And that is what you need to read today. That's why the Bible says, David says, thy word have I hid in my heart. For what reason? That I might not sin against thee. But if you're not reading the word, number one, you will sin against God. Number two, you're not going to know what he sounds like. And that's the problem that little Samuel had. He did not yet know the Lord. Jesus said, I am the word. Thy word, Christ, have I hidden my heart. God sent his son to become the word for us. And we find here now, verse 8, the Lord called Samuel a third time. Samuel. Samuel gets up and he arises. He goes to priest Eli. Priest Eli says, you know, I didn't call you, Samuel. Again, I didn't call you. Go lie down. But Eli's thinking now, and he's finally awake, and he says, I bet you that's God. Samuel, the next time you hear that voice calling your name, you say the following words. You say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. Now, you can imagine for a little boy to remember these words, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. Samuel goes to lie down. Samuel's resting, and all of a sudden, the voice calls Samuel. And the voice says, Samuel, twice, not one time, twice now. Notice Samuel's words. Eli said to him, say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. Samuel's so nervous, he says, speak, for your servant hears. He totally forgets the word Lord. And when the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I will do something in Israel at which both ears of everyone will begin to tingle. Tingle. That's interesting. When you get a tingling in your ear, what do you do with your ears? Do you just kind of deal with it? I tend to be a little bit of a joker, if you know me, and I always like to play around with people. Especially when we're outside, I like to get the long grass. And then when people are sitting there, I'll get them and tickle their ears with it. It's always hilarious when you tickle their ears because they think it's a mosquito or something like that. And you'll see them doing this. And then you go back and you do the same thing again, and it tickles their ears. You know, Paul said something about tickling ears too. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3 and 4, he says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine because they have itching ears, and they will heap up for themselves teachers. who will turn their attention away from the Word of God. Listen to me very carefully. We are in that time period now. If you do not know the Word of God, God will have your ears tickled. And the tickling of your ears is because people will hear what they want to hear in these last days. And the problem with that is they will heap up for themselves teachers. You do the same thing with your parents. Because you know, one, maybe it's daddy. Daddy's going to say, no, you can't do that. But mom will say, yes, you can do that. So you're going to play the game. If you want the yes, you're not going to ask your dad. You're going to go to your mom, right? Because you know you can get the yes answered that way. Don't say you don't do it because y'all do it. And that's exactly what happens in the last days. We're going to heap up for ourselves teachers that will not tell us no, but will tell us yes. They're going to tell us what we want to hear because we want our ears tickled, because our ears are itchy. They want to hear the yes. And when you hear the yes, the problem is it's not always the truth. We're told in the spirit of prophecy, Mrs. White says, if when the Lord reveals your error, you do not confess, his providence will bring you over the ground again and again. You will continue to lack wisdom. You will call sin righteousness and righteousness sin. And the multitude of deceptions that prevail in the last days will encircle you, and you will change leaders and not know you have done so. This is a time in which we're living right now, where people are changing leaders, they're changing and serving God, or they're serving mammon, money, or they're serving Satan. But they think in their heart, I'm doing the right thing. Maybe your parents who are listening, because I noticed during the song service there that there were a lot of old young people there. So let me speak to the older young people for a minute. I'm sure that there are times within your church where you've had issues with some of the leadership around because they're doing different things. Well, we're in that time period right now. Everything that can be done is being done. Satan is pulling out all the stops right now, and he's not going to let loose. He's not going to just take it easy on you. No, you see, the whole point is this. You're on the Zoom meeting right now. And because you're here on the Zoom meeting, you may be kind of sometimes disobedient to your parents. Sometimes you're listening in church and you really want to soak it in. But then in the same time, you're doing what you want to do Sabbath afternoon. Here's something to think about. We as Seventh-day Adventists may have the day of worship correct, but Satan will get us in the way of worship. We may have the day, but we may not have the way right. And we will have those itching ears. And then that's when trouble starts. You see, the last days, when you can't hear God, you're going to be desperate. Desperate to know, well, God, will you speak to me? Many years ago, I was in a plane crash. I should have died, as the sister read in my bio. I am living on borrowed time, and God is a very, very gracious God. I should have died in this plane crash that crashed into the lake. I'm not going to tell you much more about it because, look, you guys are young people. You're tech savvy. You probably have a smartphone. If not, you have Wi-Fi. You're going to hop on your iPad, your tablet, or you're going to get on the computer. If you go on YouTube and you punch in my name, Alden Ho, A-L-D-E-N-H-O, don't do it now because you're listening to the sermon, but write it down. Alden Ho testimony, or it's called Life is a Gift. There's one that's an interview. You don't want the interview. You want to hear the full sermon on that. Listen to that story and it will tell you the whole thing. But this is where I'm going with it. I am in the hospital bed now. I've jumped the story. I'm in the hospital bed. I'm yelling at God, what do you want with my life? And I'm yelling that. You know what I heard? Nothing. I didn't hear a thing. What do you want, God? You see, here's something you have to understand. Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9 says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. God is not going to speak to you exactly when you want him to speak to you. He will speak to you when he's ready to speak to you. He will tell you what to do when he's ready to tell you what to do. And he will direct you when he thinks you're ready to be directed. That tends to be a problem for some people because they get to be impatient. Impatience is one of the big problems in the world today. I have that problem. I'm not a very patient person. The Lord is working on me. If you ask the Lord and say, I need patience, then he will make sure that your impatience is tested all the way. Saul had this problem, King Saul. He had lost the ability to hear God's voice. By the way, when I spoke to God and I said, what do you want with my life? He didn't answer me for the first year, nor the second year, nor the third year, nor the fourth, nor the fifth, nor the sixth, until the seventh year. When he had gone through all the things that I thought I was being successful in, unbeknownst to me, he was training me the whole time. Then after I was trained, then he speaks and he says, okay, now this is what I want you to do. You see, we don't anticipate that time period. So that's part of the problem that Samuel had, or King Saul had. Turn with me, if you will, to 1 Samuel chapter 28. 1 Samuel chapter 28. Now, let's lay a little bit of the groundwork here for me, for you. Samuel is now dead. Saul is not hearing God speaking. Imagine, you can't, God's not answering by his prophets. God's not answering through the high priest, through the Urim and the Thummim. God's not speaking to Saul. You know why? Because Saul did not obey God. Let me back up for a moment. Samuel, the prophet, told Saul, look, when you go to war here, you're to totally annihilate the enemy. Annihilate them. Sheep, ox, everything. Everything, including the king. They came back from the war and they got a booty that they brought back with them. They had sheep, goats, lambs, all that. And the king was there too. Samuel walks in the camp, unaware of all this. And, you know, he's saying, so how did it go, Saul? Oh, it went well. And then all of a sudden you hear this, and Samuel's like, what's that? Oh, Saul says, oh, that's the sheep. We just, they had a lot of good sheep. So we didn't want to kill them. So we just brought the sheep over and we thought that would be okay because we wanted to save some of the best spoils. And Samuel's like, didn't you hear the instructions? The instructions I gave you that God said was destroy everything. Saul said, but, you know, I thought, you see, that's the problem all the time when we say, I thought. It's not about what I think, it's what God says. And if God says it, and then we throw our I think or I feel, forget that. That's not God speaking. That's you interpreting God, which is wrong. God said, totally annihilate. And that's what you should have done. So as a result of that, God's spirit left Saul. Gone. Saul now is desperate. He wants to know what's going on. He's not hearing God through his spirit. He's not answering through the high priest, through the Urim and the Thummim. So he goes to the witch of Endor. And he goes over there, and we're finding this in verse 3. Now Samuel had died, and Israel had lamented for him and buried him in Ramah. Chapter 28, 1 Samuel, verse 3. And Saul had put the mediums and the spiritists out of the land. Verse 4, then the Philistines gathered together, and they came and encamped at Shunem. So Saul gathered all the army together and encamped at Gilboa. When Saul saw the army of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart trembled greatly. And when Saul inquired of the Lord did not answer him, either by dreams or by the Urim or by the prophets. Then Saul said to the servants, find me a woman who has a medium, that I may go to her and inquire of her. Wow, that's all I can say. I mean, here you are trying to speak to God. Okay, no answer. Okay, let's just call the devil now and see. Maybe he'll answer, and he'll, you know, he didn't look at it from that standpoint, but he was desperate. He wanted to know God's voice. So here's what we find. They find this witch, and the servant said to him, in fact, yes, there's a woman who is a medium in Endor. Now, remember, Saul is head and shoulders above everybody else, right? So he's a tall dude. You can't hide a tall dude who's probably, you know, think of Shaquille O'Neal. How do you hide Shaquille O'Neal? I mean, you don't hide somebody like that when he walks in. Whoa. So Saul does his best to cover up. He goes in and he goes to see the witch of Endor. And verse 8 says, so Saul disguises himself. He puts on other clothes. Obviously, he takes off his kingly robes. And he went in, and two men were with him. They came to the woman by night. Why do you think it was by night? Because that's when all the bad stuff happens. You know, when your parents say you need to be home at a certain time, there's nothing good that happens at nighttime. All the weird stuff happens at nighttime. That's when people get trouble. That's when many people die too at nighttime because they get shot. So don't hang out at nighttime. The rest of verse 8, Saul says, please conduct a seance for me and bring up the one I shall name to you. Verse 9, then the woman says, look, you know what Saul has done. He has cut off the mediums and the spiritists from the land. And then why do you try to, you're laying a snare, you're trying to trick me. This is what Saul says. As the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing. What? Since when did God die and make Saul God? Right? So Saul now says to her, I want you to bring up for me Samuel. The woman does her little spirit thing, brings up Samuel. Now, wake up. Was that really Samuel? No, that wasn't Samuel. Look, the devil's really good, man. He can make Samuel look like Samuel, but it's not Samuel. He can make the demon sound like Samuel. He can make the demon act like Samuel. Whatever it is, you're going to look at this. It might be a hologram. It's not Samuel. It is all the devil, 100%. And so here's Saul. He thinks that he's speaking to Samuel, but he's in fact speaking face to face with the devil. The witch finally realizes, wait, you're no ordinary dude. You're King Saul. He says, don't be afraid. What do you see? He's so focused on that. What do you see? And the king said to her, don't be afraid. Just tell me what you see. She says, I saw a spirit ascending out of the earth. Look, symbolically, when you come out of the earth, that's the devil. He's the ruler of this area here. If it comes down from the top, that's God. God's not going to come out of the earth. Only the bad things come out of the earth. Verse 13. Do not be afraid. Okay. 14, sorry. And he said to her, what is his form? Like, what's he look like? Because you see him. What's he look like? And she says, he's an old man coming up. He's covered in a mantle. Oh, yeah, that's Saul. That's for him for sure. His face is stooped to the ground and he bowed low. Wait a second. Listen to this. And Saul perceived it was Samuel. Was it? So what did Saul do? He stooped down with his face where? His nose was to the ground. He bowed down and he was paying homage, not to God, but to the devil. It was the devil. Now Samuel said to Saul, why have you disturbed me by bringing me up? It's not Samuel, remember. Saul says, well, I'm deeply distressed, for the Philistines make war against me, and God has departed from me. Okay. And he does not answer me anymore, neither by prophets nor by dreams. Therefore, I have called you, that you may reveal to me what I should do. Then Samuel said, so why do you ask me, seeing the Lord has departed from you and has become your enemy? Wow, that's huge. Obviously, the devil's keen on this. He knows when you're disconnected from God. When you're disconnected from God, you know what he says? You're all mine. I own you. And that's exactly what happened. He owns Samuel. Then he says to him, because you did not obey the voice of God, nor execute his fierce wrath upon Amalek, therefore the Lord has done this thing to you this day. The devil got the memo. He already knows what was going on. He was paying attention. Moreover, the Lord will also deliver Israel from you into the hand of the Philistines. And here's the bad news. That was the good news. The bad news is, and tomorrow you and your sons will be with me. And the devil will also deliver the army of Israel into the hand of the Philistines. You're done. You're done, Saul. Wow. Think about that for a moment. How many of us today, as we're living, we've sold out to the devil? Let me ask you a question. Do you watch music videos? Do you watch R-rated movies? Do you do things that you know that your parents told you not to do that you're doing? Maybe you sold out too. Maybe you're not walking the walk, you're just talking it. So here's a chance for you. This week is all about revival. You're not so far gone until you're dead. The Lord has given you an opportunity. And when you're dead, there's no changing things. So you need to live for God while you have the chance. And that chance is now. Why? Because you see, yesterday you can't change. Yesterday we call history. Tomorrow, you don't know about tomorrow. Tomorrow, we call that a mystery, because anything could happen. Today is given to you. It's wrapped up in a small little present. That's why it's called the present. It's a gift. Today is a gift from God. My testimony title is actually, Life is a Gift. Life is a gift from God. What you do with your life is your gift to God. Let's go to another story. In the New Testament, we find the story in Acts chapter 9, verse 10. Acts chapter 9, verse 10. Now, this is a really good story too. They're all great stories. I like this one. This is also about another Saul, but not the same one from the Old Testament. In Acts 9, verse 10, now there was a certain disciple at Damascus called Ananias. To him, the Lord had given a vision. Ananias, he says, here I am, Lord. Notice he answers right away. So the Lord said to him, arise, go to the street called Straight and inquire of the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he is praying. And in a vision, he had seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him so that he might receive sight. Ananias responds in verse 13. I love this. Lord, I'm not sure if you got this text message about this, but you see, this Saul guy, he's the one that's coming over here to kill us. I mean, he's doing away with all the Christians. And the Lord says, yeah, I know. But you see, he's a chosen vessel of mine, and he's going to take my name, and he's going to go before Gentiles. He's going to be going before kings. He's going to go before the children of Israel. I'm going to show him many things he must do and many things he must suffer for my name's sake. So you just go and do what I've asked you. Saul's there. He's got these scaly things on his eyes. He was blinded on this road to Damascus. This bright light from heaven, notice from heaven, not from the earth, shines down on him. He falls off the horse. He is totally blinded. His helpers, his assistants, take him to the street. How they get to straight street, I'm not sure. How they knew that that was the one, look, God can do things, and God did things. So here's Saul, 3 days. He didn't sleep. He didn't eat. He didn't drink. He's there, totally blind, sitting in a chair, thinking, meditating, and praying. In those 3 days, his life changed. He had that conversion experience. No longer was he out to annihilate the Christians, the Jewish Christians, the Judeo Christians. Saul now was a changed man. Verse 17, Ananias went his way, entered the house, and laid hands on him, saying, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, there was from his eyes something like scales, and they left. They fell off. And what happened? Immediately, his sight was restored, and he arose, and he was baptized that quick. You see, there are many challenges for us today. The challenges that we face have to do with listening to God, listening to the voice of God. There's another story that's found, go back one chapter to Acts chapter 8. In Acts chapter 8, verse 26, now the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, arise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert. And so he arose and he went. And behold, a man from Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge over all the treasury, had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning. He was sitting in his chariot, and he was reading Isaiah the prophet. And what happens? As he's reading Isaiah the prophet, then the Spirit said to Philip, go near, overtake this chariot. So Philip runs to him, and he heard him reading from the prophet Isaiah. Then he says to him, hey, man, do you know what you're reading? The eunuch says, how can I, unless somebody explains it to me? So Philip comes in, and he explains it to him. Very important verse, because this is where it's important to have people that can help you with your understanding of scriptures. You may be in a rudimentary beginning stages of trying to listen to God and trying to understand God. This is important for us because as we listen to God through reading his word, sometimes we have to ask other people. You know, we're told that we have to have a multitude of elders in the last days. The deceptions that are happening today are so very tricky. Even myself as a minister, as a pastor, I still have a multitude of elders, other friends who are pastors, and we consult together. Certain things pop up. Some people claim that they're prophets, and we analyze, we pray, we talk about these things, and we're trying to find where the error is so we know, is it truth or is it error? Because we're told in the spirit of prophecy, so closely will the counterfeit resemble the true that it will be impossible to distinguish between them except through Holy Scriptures. So, once again, not only do you need the Scriptures to be able to hear the voice of God, but you need to know the Scriptures in order to identify where the deception is. You know, that you might have heard this many years ago or sometime in an illustration that counterfeit specialists who specialize in identifying counterfeit dollar bills, they never study a dollar bill, a fake one. They only study the real thing. And by studying the real thing over and over and over meticulously, they can pick up a fake one and say, that's fake, just by the touch, just by the weight, just by the texture. They know because they've held the real thing. My friends, are you holding the real thing? Are you so in tune with God that you can identify that's a fake? That's not God speaking. That's the devil speaking. We have to, in the last days, be so in tune with God that we will hear him speaking, not so much to our ears, but to our heart. In Desire of Ages, page 489, it said the following. With every knock unheeded, what knock? Revelation 3:20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. What door is that? That's the door of our heart. God is trying to come into our heart to sup with us, to make the changes, to come and enter into our lives. For what purpose? Well, Galatians 2:20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who gave himself for me. So as we open the door of our heart, we are allowing Christ to take control of our lives and to speak to us through his word. And this is why he knocks at the door. But he knocks, and sometimes we don't answer because we're watching something. He knocks, but sometimes we're with our friends. He knocks, but sometimes we're busy doing things that we shouldn't be doing. We're playing on Satan's playground, and we don't want God to ruin our fun. And it says, with every knock unheeded, the disposition, the ability to open becomes weaker. The impressions of the Holy Spirit, if disregarded today, will not be as strong tomorrow, because the heart becomes less impressible and lapses into the perilous unconsciousness of the shortness of life and the great eternity beyond. That is a problem. We don't hear this. And the problem with all of that comes to this. Our condemnation in the judgment will not result from the fact that we have been in error, but from the fact that we have neglected heaven-sent opportunities for learning what is truth. Do you hear that? We have neglected heaven-sent opportunities for learning what is truth. Look, you may be a youth. This is a youth thing, but I know in the U.S., youth is technically 13 to 19. But everywhere else in the world that I've preached, in the 30 different countries I've preached at, youth are basically 18 to like 35. So I'm sure that's probably the case over there, because I saw a lot of old youth up there singing. So here's the issue that we have. God is trying to speak to you in the last days. In Ecclesiastes 12:1, it says, remember now your creator in the days of your youth. That's you. And God is sending you a message ahead of time saying, look, don't be so focused on Instagram, Snapchat, Facebook, whatever social media may be putting out there. Focus in on hiding the word of God in your heart, because one of these days, the Bible is going to disappear. I preach from an iPad. Everything is on my iPad, but I have the paper versions of everything. And one of these days, all this is going to disappear. The electronics won't be able to charge them. Somebody's going to break in and steal them. But that's why it's important to hide everything in your word, the word of God, in your heart, in your mind. God wants to write it in your frontal lobe. Why? Because that's where the decision-making takes place. Satan wants access to that. And he wants that so that he could use you for his army. But we're told that an army of youth rightly trained can do a whole lot of good. But are you willing to be an army rightly trained? You see, the challenge that we have in the last days is God is going to speak. God is speaking. God will continue to speak. The question is this: can you hear him? Here's the reason why. Let me give you a story, probably one of my most favorite stories. In the country of Brazil, there was a lady who had four children. Her children were very young. Her husband left her. There was absolutely no food in the house. The refrigerator wasn't working anymore. The cupboards were all bare. The children were hungry. She walked into her room, her bedroom. She told the children, "I am going to be praying. Do not disturb me." For 2 hours, she pleaded with the Lord, "Lord, we need food. The children don't have food. Please show us. Please supply our needs." You know what? Remember what I said, listening is very important. Too many times we talk. We talk and talk and talk and talk. You know, sometimes we just need to shut up. We need to keep our mouths shut. And this is why praying is one thing. Meditating is listening for the voice of God. She prayed, she meditated, she listened, and the Holy Spirit spoke to her. And the Holy Spirit said, "You need to go to El Dorado's. It's a big grocery store." When I say big, I mean huge. They have 128 checkouts. She went through there. The instructions were, go to El Dorado's, get all the groceries you need, not for 1 month, not for 2 months, but for 3 months. Get all the groceries you need for 3 months and go to checkout stand number 7. Here she is pushing her buggy around, her cart. She got all the groceries, one cart, two carts. She's going through checkout stand. Remember, 128 checkout stands. She's going to checkout stand number 7. Why would it be number 7? Because that's God's number. Number 7, she gets there and the lady says, "I'm sorry, I'm going to lunch." Turns off the light for the number 7 lit up. And so what does she do now? The person, the checkout stand person working at number 6 and number 8 says, "Hey, you can come over to us." She says, "No. My father told me to go to number 7. So she waits. The lady left for lunch. An hour later, the lady comes back from lunch and she says, "What? You're still here?" She says, "Yes. My father told me to go through number 7. She said, "Yeah, whatever." So now she turns on the light and she starts taking the food and starts checking the food through. This lady's emptying the cart, putting it all on the conveyor belt, passing it all down. The last item goes down the conveyor belt. Her cart is empty. They're all being bagged. She has 20 cruzados to her name. It's something like 10 cents. That's all she has in her purse. The lady rings up the total and says, "This is the total." And this woman just stands there and smiles because her God just told her, go to checkout stand number 7. There were no further instructions given. So you just have to wait on the Lord. So she waited. And the lady's looking at her like, "You're going to pay for this?" All of a sudden, over the loudspeaker of the store, the voice is heard. "Welcome to El Dorado's." It was the manager. "Welcome to El Dorado's. Today is a very special day. Today we are celebrating our 7th anniversary. And to celebrate our 7th anniversary, the person at checkout stand number 7 gets their groceries free today." Can you say amen to that? Amen. You see, this right here is the exact reason why you need to be able to hear the voice of God. Because if you can't hear the voice of God, you're not going to hear number 7. You're not going to hear to wait on the Lord. You're not going to hear the instructions to get 3 months of groceries. You're going to be listening and asking the devil for some McDonald's instead. You need to listen to the voice of God, because God will speak, not in a big voice, but in a still small voice. Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says, "Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." You will not know God unless you study his word. And when you study his word, you know what he sounds like, because you know the words, and then he will speak to you through his words. as you wait for him. I want to close with this verse. In John chapter 10, verse 4 and 5, John writes and he says, "And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. Yet they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers." Young people, do you know the voice of God? Are you listening in? Are you hiding that word within your heart? Because one of these days, everything is going to be taken away, and all you have left is what's here. You're going to be called before kings and magistrates, before legislation, to give an answer for what you believe. This is the proving ground right now. This is where the litmus test happens. You have to start learning now. Some people say, "Well, I'm not going to tell people about God. I'm not going to witness." If you don't witness, you're not used to standing up and you're not used to explaining what you believe. If you're not used to doing that now and you don't want to learn, then you're not going to be able to give an answer in the future. The future is right around the corner. The future could be next week. Things are happening very, very, very quickly in this world. And the Lord needs you. He died for you. And I ask and pray that you will find it, that you would open that door of your heart when Jesus knocks and say, "Lord, come in. I need you here, and I don't ever want you to leave." Hide God's word in your heart. Let's pray. Father in heaven, as we come to you, all we have, all we know that we can trust is your word. And Lord, we ask and pray that you would solidify us in the faith, that you would strengthen us, because we know that although we are in the shaking time period right now, there is more coming, and it's going to get worse. But our faith is in you. You will bring us through. You promised everything to us. Help us to trust you in all that we do, in all that we say. May we live for you. And let God's people say, amen. God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Brethren, open your mics and just the message has gone forth.
Praise God.
The message has gone forth.
Thank you, Lord.
Simple, simple, brethren. Simple, with clarity, mm-hmm. with understanding. Mm-hmm. The Lord has presented his word. What more can he say to us? What more? At this time, we are going to take final prayer from Michael McNeil, Brother Michael McNeil Jr. Dion. We're going to take a final prayer from one of our youth.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we have sat and listened to your word being spilled in this space, we ask now that it will not simply dry up in our hearts, that it will be absorbed within us, that it will grow within us, and that it will flourish in our daily lives and in our character, and in our outlook and our relationship with you. We ask God that you'd remember that we are weak and mortal and prone to forgetfulness. Send your Holy Spirit, Father, to remind us of just how important it is to remain in constant contact with you, to remind us to listen a bit more than we speak, to remind us, Father, to look up, not down, and to always remain focused on what you have to say and what you mean, not what we think, what we want. Help us, God, to move forward now in our lives with a renewed sense of purpose and drive. Direct our steps, order them according to your word, and develop our character in the likeness of your Son. It is in his name that we pray these things. Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. At this time, we bid you all a pleasant and good night. And tomorrow we invite you back. And we will be hearing another message from Pastor Alden Ho. So we invite you. And before I go, we're going to press the link. We're going to share it. We're going to find our young people. Yes, we know some of them are in our homes. And we're going to share it also with our neighbors and our classmates and our co-workers. We're going to invite them. These times, as Pastor Ho said, things are happening very fast, quick. And it's when we hide the word of God in our heart. And we have to spend time with him. Once it is dear, it is a surety that whatever the storm and the wind that the devil threw at us, we know that we are rooted in Christ Jesus. Until tomorrow, have a blessed night, a pleasant night, and we will see you tomorrow again at 7:15. We will now depart with our departure song. We are nearing home.
Oh, there's a mountain in the promised land. There's a holy city built by God's own hands. As our weary footsteps in the mountains crest, we can feel our homeland of eternal rest. We are nearing home. We are nearing. There we soon will enter nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home. My brother, my sister, will you meet us there? In the land of sunshine where there'll be no accept of God's message and to him be true. Then when Jesus comes, he will call for you. We are nearing home. We are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. Very soon we'll enter nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home.